Welcome to the American Academy's first Zoom program. It's especially nice to see all of your faces and to bring together such a geographically diverse group. We have registrations from more than 30 cities, from Cambridge to Cleveland, Tallahassee, Los Angeles, and even Mainz, Germany. Since the Academy has postponed all of our events and travel through July 1, we're thrilled for the chance to connect with members in the current circumstances. Academy staff are working remotely. The election of new members is proceeding, and we continue to make progress on our ongoing projects and publications while also considering new ways to help the country emerge from this crisis. One of the projects that's especially relevant at this time is on the public face of science, chaired by Dick Meserve, who joins us on this call. This project aims to help the scientific community understand public attitudes towards science and ultimately improve the practice of science communication and engagement. Last year, the project published a report titled Science During Crisis: Best Practices, Research Needs, and Policy Priorities, which was co-authored by Rita Colwell, who also joins us today. She spoke at a panel on this topic at the annual meeting of the American Association for the Advancement of Science in February, where she emphasized the report's recommendations that state science advisors can play a key role during crises like COVID-19 to facilitate the application of science and liaise between state and local government, emergency responders, and the scientific community. During the current crisis, the importance of effectively communicating scientific realities to the public has never been clearer. Which is why we are very lucky to be joined today by Harvard Professor of the History of Science and Affiliated Professor of Earth and Planetary Sciences, Naomi Oreskes. Thank you, Naomi, for being with us today. Naomi is an internationally recognized voice on the climate crisis and the role of science in society. She's become a familiar face in Washington, recently testifying before Congress on the fossil fuel industry's role in global warming. Her 2010 book, Merchants of Doubt, How a Handful of Scientists Obscured the Truth on Issues from Tobacco Smoke to Global Warming, is considered an essential text for understanding the origins of widespread climate change denial and public skepticism of science in general. It has been adopted into a documentary film and will be re-released with an introduction from Al Gore this year. Naomi's most recent book, Why Trust Science, explores the social character of scientific knowledge in a world increasingly mistrustful of experts. The book takes the question of why trust science seriously and uses historical examples to illustrate the power of consensus in settling certain facts. Many of you may have seen Naomi's recent interview with The New Yorker that appeared under the headline, How to Talk to Coronavirus Skeptics. It's a fascinating interview that addresses our current situation as well as makes connections to our climate crisis and the larger role of experts in society. We've asked Naomi to make some opening comments, and then we look forward to a healthy period for questions. So now let me turn things over to Naomi Oreskes. Naomi?
Thank you, David. Can you hear me? Good. Okay. Well, thank you so much for the honor of being the first person to launch the Zoom webinars. And it's really an honor to see so many people, including some nice friends on this chat today. So I'm not going to talk for a long time. I don't have formal notes prepared. I'm not going to show slides. I'm just going to talk about a few things that have been on my mind in relation to the coronavirus and my own work on the subject of the acceptance or rejection of scientific knowledge. Some of you had the chance to hear me speak at the Academy a few months ago on my new book, Why Trust Science. But I'm not really going to focus on that today specifically. And the reason for that is, well, let me say a few words about that book. So I didn't write that book to convince skeptics about the virtues of science. That was not the purpose of it. The purpose of that book really was to give a principled account, a credible and defensible account of the answer to that question, why trust science? In other words, if we ask the question, what is the basis for thinking that scientific knowledge is broadly reliable, that in general, we can use scientific knowledge to do things we want in the world and our efforts will be likely in most cases to be successful. What is the answer to that question of why science is reliable in so many cases? And my position as a historian of science is that it's not what a lot of people think. It's not what a lot of people say. So many people, if that question is put to them, they would say, well, science is reliable because of the scientific method. We use the scientific method and that gives us reliable results. History of science doesn't support that position. And so the book was an attempt to give a better answer, a better explanation to that question. So in the book, I review about 150 years of philosophy and history of science, and make the case for the reality of the social nature of scientific investigations and the way in which the collective vetting of claims is really crucial to the claim of reliability. I also look at some specific examples in the history of science where in hindsight we would say that scientists didn't do so well. And what we find from those examples, and I don't claim that they're representative, I only claim that they're examples that I understand and that I know something about, we find that in all of those cases, there actually was not a consensus, that in fact, scientists were divided among themselves. So if people say, oh, scientists used to have a consensus that the Earth was flat, or scientists used to have a consensus, you know, X, Y, Z, whatever it is, what we find in all of the cases that I looked at was that actually there wasn't a consensus. And so this tells us that consensus is an extremely important analytic category. Obviously, it's not the same as truth, but it is a marker. It's a marker that a scientific community has come to agreement on a topic. And that's telling us something important about the state of knowledge, the state of evidence regarding that question. So if we segue though to the question of, well, what do we say to skeptics? Because that book is not intended to persuade a climate change denier that climate change is real, nor would I expect that it would persuade them. So why is that? Well, if you had the opportunity to look at the interview, or if you've read any of my earlier work, particularly Merchants of Doubt, what you know is that I argue that, and this is consistent also with survey work that has been done, including the very excellent report that the Academy put out. I think it was it last year, David, the report on American views on science? That was a great report. I loved it because it agreed completely with everything I had already said. It's always good when you make an argument on theoretical grounds and then the empirical evidence backs you up. No, my argument was partly empirical as well because it was based on the people we had studied, but it wasn't a large survey. So what we found in our own work, which is in fact confirmed by the Academy and other studies, is that when people reject climate science or other areas of science, it's not because the science is weak science. So the example I like to use is people don't refuse to get vaccinations because immunology is bad science. In fact, most people who refuse to get vaccinations probably don't even know what immunology is. And if they do, they probably have no principled objection to immunology as a science. But they're hurting. Their children are sick with a terrible disease, autism. And when they go to their doctor and they say, well, what caused this disease? The doctor says, honestly, we don't know. And for many parents, that's a very unsatisfying answer. And so people are looking for answers. And we see this in many areas of science. So when people reject science, it's typically what I refer to, what people call implicatory denial. And by that, what we mean is that people reject science when they don't like the implications. So if a parent of an autistic child rejects the explanation that it's not caused by vaccinations, they don't like that. They want there to be an answer. They want there to be an explanation. And so if someone else comes along and says, oh, but there is an explanation. It's that vaccination that your child had only weeks before the child got sick. That feels more satisfying for many people. And we see similar forms of implicatory denial in almost every area, or I would argue actually all major areas where we see large scale public rejection. So in the case of evolution, we have good evidence to show that people who reject evolutionary theory, many of them do so because they don't like what they perceive to be the implications. The implication that there's no God, the implication that everything is random and therefore life is meaningless. I'll get to what the implications of this are for us. Or if we look at climate change, this was the major argument of Merchants of Doubt, that the prominent climate change deniers who we studied, they weren't objecting to the science. They weren't saying, oh, the error bars are too big, or I don't agree with the parameterization of the cloud feedbacks in the GFDL model. No, that's not what's going on. What's going on is they're saying, I don't believe it because I don't think the federal government should intervene in the marketplace to fix it. And that's a pretty big intellectual leap, right? And so when we were doing our work and we saw that these people were in fact making this leap, we tried to fill in the dots. We tried to connect the causal chain, and we came to understand that these were conservatives, in the case of the people we studied, cold warriors, scientists who had worked on the atomic bomb and the hydrogen bomb and the other weaponry programs, who believed passionately in free market capitalism, believed passionately in the connection between economic freedom and political freedom, and feared that if the government intervened in the marketplace, whether it was to control tobacco smoking or to control the ozone hole or to stop acid rain or to prevent climate change, that we would be on a slippery slope to socialism. And we see implicatory denial of that kind in almost all climate change denial in the United States. It's a fear of accepting, of acknowledging what fundamentally is a failure of capitalism. In a way, it's the Naomi Klein argument, although I don't agree with the conclusion she comes to. The merchants of doubt believe that if climate change were true, it was the end of capitalism. I mean, that's a slight exaggeration of their position, but only very slight. Naomi Klein comes along and says, they're right, it is the end of capitalism. So I don't agree with that conclusion. I think that in a sense, she thinks about it the same way the deniers do, but that's the crux of the argument. Does this change everything? Do we have to abandon capitalism? Or are there ways to fix this problem short of changing everything? My own view is it doesn't change everything, but it does change some things. It changes the way we have to generate and use energy. But these implicatory consequences are very deep, they're very important, and they're driving most rejection of science. So what does that tell us? What are the implications of that for us? Well, what it tells us is that we will not address these people's concerns by giving them more science. We won't eliminate climate change denial by reducing the error bars in our models or by nailing down those cloud feedbacks. We will not persuade evolution rejectors by giving them more data about the evolution, let's say, of horses. But we might be able to persuade them, and again, we have evidence to support this, particularly in the evolutionary theory space, if we can actually address those implications and say, well, hold on a minute. I understand the concern, but actually evolution doesn't really mean that life is meaningless. And let me show you something written by Ken Miller, who's a great scientist and a religious Catholic, or let me show you something by Sir John Houghton, who's a great scientist and evangelical Protestant, and to show you the way these scientists find meaning in their lives, even while they also promote evolutionary theory. So I think that summarizes sort of my main point from this work, and I think that might be a good place to open it up for conversation.
Good. Would someone like to either raise their hand or speak using the chat method?
Sure. Okay, now I'm on mute. Hi, Naomi. Nice to see you again.
Hi, Katja. Nice to see you.
There are a couple of things. One is that it seems to, I read your Los Angeles Times piece that was just sent out a couple hours ago, and in that you mentioned about that this all, some of this stems all the way back to Ronald Reagan. But it seems to me that there is some point at which even the deniers, you know, have to change their mind. Ronald Reagan changed his mind on the Montreal Protocol when it was pointed out to him how much the chlorofluorocarbon was affecting the U.S. and how many deaths that we were suffering. It's not like it was, well, we would reduce the deaths globally, so it wasn't a global thing, but when it was shown to affect directly. In a way, Trump, you know, started off denying the COVID-19 virus as something that was, not something to worry about, but then he changed his tune, and he changed his tune after it became patently evident that people were dying of this and that. And so I'm wondering if there isn't some lessons that one can learn by looking at the point at which deniers change their view. Because after all, if science is right and they're wrong, there's going to be some evidence that's going to arrive at some point where they're going to change their mind. I don't know about evolution, but certainly about climate change. So I wanted to comment on that point.
Yeah, I think that's a really tricky question, because there's no question that sometimes what's hard about these issues is that the consequences are far off or appear to be far away, either in time or in space. And certainly we saw that problem with acid rain, we saw it with the ozone hole, and we see it with climate change. So it's certainly the case that with the coronavirus, as it began to be clear that there were cases in the United States, that it was spreading rapidly and that people were already dying, I think that certainly did make a difference. And so the immediacy of a problem is clearly important. But that raises a couple of problems. One is because you know, we often face problems where the causal chain is a little bit complex. There's a couple of steps, and the immediacy can always be talked away. So we have, people have died from climate change. If you look at, say, the fires in California this year, the fires in Australia, we have good scientific evidence that these fires were definitely made worse by lack of soil moisture and higher temperatures associated with climate change. So we, people have died. Climate change is no longer in the future. It is now immediate. And yet we still see tremendous resistance. And so I think this is evidence for the importance of the ideological component, that even when people are suffering, even when people are dying, people will still try to resist the implications, try to resist that conclusion and come up with some explanation, say, well, we don't really know that those fires were caused by climate change. And we saw that a lot during the Australian fires, during the California fires, climate change deniers trying to challenge the causal link that connected them. And so this is why I feel so strongly that we actually do have to address the ideological component and figure out some way to get around it, because we've seen, and you know, we've known about climate change for more than 30 years now. And we've seen how, even as the evidence gets stronger, yes, some people are persuaded by the evidence, some people finally shift, but most of them don't. Most of them come up with more and more excuses. They come up with new excuses, they come up with creative excuses, but the number of, say, Americans who still reject climate change, it's changed somewhat in the last few years, but it hasn't actually changed that much. And so that's telling us that the growing body of scientific data is not the thing that is determinative as much as we would like it to be.
Thanks, Naomi. I see Dick Meserve has a question.
Yeah, thank you. I've been following your work for some time and really appreciate the opportunity to see you by way of video. I have a somewhat subtly different theory on the climate change issue, that it's not so much that that people think that if they accept it, they have to accept the failure of capitalism, so much as the related point that they're mostly conservative Republicans that take that position. And so your membership in that group requires sort of acceptance of a group philosophy towards an issue. And you're unwilling to accept facts because it somehow challenges the group with which you've affiliated yourself. And I think that may be true for evolution as well, that there are people who believe in the literal truth of the Bible, and they see that the acceptance of the science associated with evolution requires something that's contrary to a very fundamental belief to them. So that it's a somewhat different perspective on the issue, and I wonder if you could comment.
Sure. Well, let me take the first part first on the tribalism, climate change. So you're absolutely right. There's no question that that's true. And this is a both and argument. And so obviously in my introduction, I was trying to keep this condensed. I mean, I've been studying this for 15 years. I've now written 3 books on the topic and I have a 4th one coming. So obviously, you know, we could dig in deep on a lot of the aspects of this. But the way I see it is that what you say is true, but it doesn't really explain where it came from in the first place. And of course, as a historian, I'm always interested in the origin story. I want to know, why did Republicans line up against climate change? Why did it become a point of identity for American conservatives? And this is essentially the argument in the piece in the LA Times today. So if you haven't had a chance to read that yet, I hope you will. But what we argue in that piece, which is based on now a lot of research that we've done, is that, and we could push this back very far. We could push this back to the New Deal and other earlier things, but for the sake of argument, when Ronald Reagan became president of the United States, he came to power on a platform of limited government. He said very explicitly, it was the major theme of his inaugural address, government is not the solution to our problems, government is the problem. Now, why he believed that and why he thought that is a complicated story that we could get into over a beer once we finally get to get together again. But let's just say that that's factually correct, that we know that that's true. So he did a number of things that we can argue about whether they were good or bad, cutting taxes, attempting to roll back workplace regulations, attempting to deregulate a number of markets. He carried on some deregulatory programs that had actually been put in place by President Carter. But environmental science created a huge dilemma for Ronald Reagan. when Reagan came to office, he did not have a reputation as being like horribly anti-environmental as governor of California. Now that may have been political because he knew that in California there was strong political support for environmental protection. But be that as it may, he faced a very, very big dilemma with acid rain in the ozone hole and with the emerging evidence of climate change. And this was that these were all problems that were market failures. They were all problems that pointed to the need for significant big government solutions. In the case of ozone, it was the biggest government of all, an international treaty. So what was he going to do about that? This is a clash between his fundamental principles of limited government, let the market do its magic, rely on the private sector as much as possible. But now these big problems that the private sector doesn't seem to be able to solve. And so his strategy, and this is well documented, and I spent a lot of time in the Reagan Library last year, his strategy was to downplay the science, to say, well, we're not really sure. And the clearest example of this, and I mentioned this in the LA Times piece today because it's the most crystal clear, acid rain was the big issue that was coming to the fore. The Carter administration was already deep into negotiations for a treaty with Canada, and Reagan stopped those negotiations in their tracks and actually instructed his science advisor, George Keyworth, to interfere with a major acid rain review panel that was taking place at that time, and actually gave Bill Nirenberg instructions for how to change the report to make the science seem more uncertain. And that had the impact of derailing a congressional vote that was about to happen on the acid rain issue. And so I think it set in motion a pattern of downplaying or dismissing or even outright rejecting science that clashed with the ideology of the magic of the marketplace. And I think he set in motion a set of attitudes and a set of behaviors about how to respond to science that was, to use Al Gore's phrase, inconvenient, and that became a kind of template for other Republican leaders. And so that helps to explain then why over time we see Republican voters, Republicans in Congress, Republicans in the Senate, Republicans on the state level kind of lining up against climate change denial.
Thanks. I see Jenny Mansbridge next.
Hi, Naomi. It's so good to see you. I lost the group there for a moment. I hope you can see me. I want to ask you about expressing uncertainty in science, how scientists can do that well. I read a paper recently, perhaps you have too, based on some experiments, that scientists expressing uncertainty didn't reduce citizens' beliefs in science. And so I think, for example, about the uncertainty regarding this malaria drug. The French trials didn't have good controls and so forth and so on. But that doesn't mean to say that the drug wasn't effective. It seems the New Yorker, I just glanced at a New Yorker piece that seemed to take the stance that, well, of course Trump was wrong.
Right.
No, I think that's a mistaken approach because the answer is we're not sure. It might be the case. How do you think scientists can bring uncertainty to the public in a way that helps people understand likelihoods rather than yes, no?
Yeah, that's a great question. And obviously this is a very tricky issue. So I'll try to say a few things I hope are helpful. And I don't think we'll solve this in the next 5 minutes. But I think where you started is a really important point, that we have good evidence to support the view that when people reject science, it's not because the science is too uncertain. People's rejection or skepticism about science is not caused by scientists being honest about the uncertainties. So that's very important for us because it tells us that, well, we should be honest about uncertainties because we should always be honest, because not being honest is bound to get us into trouble sooner or later, but also because science is uncertain and we won't succeed if we deny something which is so fundamental to science. So uncertainty is absolutely fundamental to science because science could not be a process of discovery if it weren't driven by uncertainty, if it weren't driven by the things we didn't know. So that's something we have to embrace, and we have to be proud of that, right? That yes, we live with uncertainty, and we're okay with that. We're comfortable with uncertainty as scientists and scholars because it drives our inquiry. That said, it gets to be delicate and difficult because we know that skeptics and deniers will use uncertainty, will try to exploit it. And we've seen this in spades in the climate change space, where climate change deniers will try to say, oh, but the models are uncertain. The scientists can't actually tell us when we'll hit 2 degrees or whatever it is. And they use that to create the impression that because we don't know everything, we don't know anything. And so that makes it hard for us as scientists to know how to respond.
Right.
So I follow the lead of people like Susan Hassel, who have studied this, and my own experience. I think the key thing that we've learned from that is that you have to lead with what you know. Don't accept the framing that it's all so uncertain, we don't know anything. So many scientists I know, many climate scientists I know, did get sucked into that framework, and they found themselves often saying things like, well, yes, it is very uncertain. No, don't do that. Start by saying, there are a lot of things we can say with clarity about this issue. So we may not have certainty, but we do have clarity. So here's what we know, and you lead with what you know. And then if the journalist or the interlocutor is still interested in the uncertainties, and then if they say, well, what about the cloud feedbacks? Then you can say, well, yes, it is true. There are things we don't understand about the cloud feedbacks, but we have, you know, 50 years of good data now, and we see that empirically, despite the cloud feedbacks, despite the uncertainties in the cloud feedbacks, the world is warming up, right? So the first order, the large scale pattern is pretty clear, even if we don't know all the details.
Thank you. Nora Newcomb has a question.
Thank you. Thanks for calling on me now, because I have a question that's a follow-up. I heard Jenny Mansbridge's question a little differently, but maybe I misheard it. The question about communicating uncertainty that I have isn't so much about the uncertainty of the theory, but the uncertainty about a particular prediction. So, for instance, we're now used to, but we didn't used to be used to, the margin of error in a political poll. There's quite a lot of data on how people construe the path of uncertainty of a hurricane. Now, in those cases, we are eventually going to know, how did the election turn out? Where did the hurricane go? So the fact that people are, they need help in interpreting even that kind of uncertainty, I think is important. Now, in some situations, you don't know how it really is. You don't know the ground truth. So if you go into court and say, you know, in 4 out of 5 cases where an eyewitness saw something under this kind of circumstance, you know, they probably are misidentifying. That doesn't mean this particular witness misidentified. And that's an irretrievable problem that we, however, are comfortable with, that people on the jury are not. So I believe there are tools from my own field, which is cognitive psychology, that help to communicate these kinds of uncertainty.
Yeah, that's a great point. And if you have some specific papers on those tools, please send them to me and to Jenny, because I'd love to know a little bit more about that. But I think, you know, you're certainly right. And so part of the question here is, who is the interlocutor? And is this a person operating in good faith or in bad faith? I've dealt a lot in my work with bad faith interlocutors, people who are basically trying to muddy the waters. And so in that kind of situation, leading with what you know is, in my opinion, essential, not buying into the uncertainty framework. If I were in a court of law as an expert witness, or if I were working with school teachers, or if I'm in my own classroom, then of course it's a bit of a different thing. And then, you know, the reality of uncertainty is a really tough one scientifically. You know, one of the examples I'm very familiar with is sometimes people will say, well, if we can't even predict the weather 6 months from now or 6 days from now, how could we possibly predict the climate 50 years from now? And of course, if you understand modeling and you understand the dynamics of the climate system, you know that actually predicting the climate 50 years from now is an easier problem than predicting it 50 days from now. And if you have time and you can sit down with someone and explain why that's the case, then, you know, you may educate that person. So it really depends on context. If I'm being interviewed by a journalist, I don't have the time to sit down and explain those things, or I usually don't. And so that's why I think we also have to be a little nimble in responding differently in different contexts.
Thank you. Alan Altshuler has a question. Alan, you're muted.
Unmute yourself, Alan.
So you could unmute me from where you were. Okay, now I'm on. Now I should be unmuted. Okay. So I'd be interested in your reflections on the political response to the COVID-19 crisis that we're going through right now, where people who were against Keynesian economics have jumped in with a $2 trillion stimulus plan. The Federal Reserve just announced today basically another $2 trillion. They're going to print money and pump into the economy. The idea that government is the problem, not the solution, seems to have not quite swept every bit of opposition away, but has certainly transformed the political landscape in the ways that in a larger sense, the Great Depression did many years ago, and so on and so forth. So the question is, do you think that there are certain great dramatic society transforming events which can at times change the basic dynamic that's been frustrating the acceptance of climate change and even evolution as a theory?
Yes, absolutely. As a historian, I would have to say for sure, we do have events, historical events, things in big ways. And the Great Depression is an obvious example in American history. So if there's a silver lining to COVID-19, I think it's exactly what you've just identified. We've seen that when there is a giant immediate crisis in front of people's faces, then suddenly some of their ideological commitments can be reconsidered. And I do think that we've seen in the last few weeks the way in which both Republicans and Democrats have been terrified that the economy is in free fall and we have to do something about it. And that, I think, opens up a space for a conversation about what is the appropriate role of government and where do we draw the line. And it may be the case that, I mean, it's almost certainly the case that most of us would say we don't want to be China. We don't want to become an authoritarian country. But there obviously is an appropriate role for government. And the pendulum in the last 40 years in this country, in my opinion, has swung far, far too far in the direction of leaving things to the private sector, and that this is an appropriate time for correction. Now, the big question, though, of course, is when this virus passes, which it will, or when we get a vaccination, which we probably will, and probably, you know, within a year, year and a half, will there be pressure from conservatives to go back to business as usual? I think the answer is definitely there will be. And so the question is, can we make the case against that? And can we make the case that climate change is as big a crisis or potentially as big a crisis as COVID-19? And I think that's going to be tough. I think those of us who have worked in the climate change space, We believe that it is. We see the ways in which climate change will threaten the economy, threaten health, threaten our lives, threaten coastal real estate, threaten biodiversity. It's already killing coral reefs. I mean, we see the way this is unfolding. It has a kind of immediacy and urgency for us, but clearly it doesn't for most of our fellow Americans, even a lot of other Democrats or liberals. So, I shouldn't say other Democrats. I'm an independent, but you know what I mean, right? So the point is, there is an opportunity to make the case here, but I think it will have to be made. I don't think that everything has now changed so that it will be obvious to everyone going forward that we need a big government intervention on climate change. I think we will have to make that argument, and I think that people who care about this issue have to be working on it now. The other thing I would say is, you know, you mentioned the Great Depression. I think that's right. The clear, obvious example, the clear, obvious parallel for us is the Great Depression, because up until the election of FDR, as most people know, there was not a strong federal government response to the economy. And Herbert Hoover was insisting that we would recover. The famous line, prosperity was just around the corner. He was an advocate of volunteerism. And I've been rereading Herbert Hoover's work in recent months. And, you know, I have great sympathy for the man. I mean, he was kind of a good guy in a lot of ways, and his arguments were not crazy. And frankly, if the private sector had done what he had suggested, American history would have been very different. So it's not to say that there aren't a variety of possible solutions that could occur, but the failure of the private sector to be able to respond in the way that Hoover advocated was, in a sense, why FDR was elected and why he was able to do. There was huge opposition to the New Deal. A lot of people have forgotten this. I mean, when the so-called Green New Deal was introduced, I warned a group of Democratic leaders that they should be prepared for all the same criticisms that the original New Deal got, that they would be called socialists, they'd be called communists, they would be, you know, accused of threatening the prosperity of the United States, and of course, all of that has happened. So yes, Roosevelt was able to do a lot of things during the Great Depression, but of course, and this is where the Ronald Reagan story comes in. I mean, the simplest way to understand the presidency of Ronald Reagan is that Ronald Reagan came to power with the goal of undoing the New Deal. And I believe that that's what Republicans in the United States have been doing for the last 40 years. And so that raises some big, big questions about how we articulate a positive vision for the role of government, but that's not China, right? That addresses some of the concerns about government overreach, but also acknowledges the problems that can't be solved by the private sector, by individuals, or by the states alone.
Right, agreeing. Can I just say one more word?
Sure.
Agreeing with everything you've just said, I think one of the interesting things about the current situation is the scientific uncertainties are so great. Mm-hmm. And the enormous uncertainties have not been frustrating action very much. And I'd be interested in your analysis as to why this case is so different in that regard from some of the others.
You mean in the scientific uncertainties regarding COVID-19?
The scientific uncertainties regarding COVID-19 have been compatible with almost instant dramatic responses by the government.
Well, there are important uncertainties, you're right, but there was one big fact that was not uncertain, was that this virus, actually I'd say two, that this virus was novel, and therefore had the potential to kill a huge number of people, and that it was in fact killing people, and that the fatality rates, that this was not just an ordinary flu, that we were not looking at fatality rates of 0.1% or less, but that we were looking at fatality rates of at least 1%, if not higher. And I think those two key facts really caused the public health community to step up and take notice and say, this is the potential frightening pandemic that we have warned about, that we have worried about, this is actually it. And so that was a crucial certainty that I think did help mobilize action. Now, as we've seen, it didn't happen fast enough, right? We should have acted in January, but we at least did act. And so we have, you know, we have, well, we don't really know yet, but it seems likely that we will not be looking at a worst case scenario here. Although, I mean, in terms of the economy, we are looking at a very, very serious effect.
Laura Green, you want to unmute yourself?
Hi, thank you very much. Naomi, it's good to meet you again. I have been following you. I don't know if you don't remember, I called you many years ago to get you to speak at the American Physical Society meeting. Your work is inspirational. And I do, besides my science, I do a lot of public outreach. And I find it very frustrating. And I think your idea of directly addressing the implications is really what we need to do. But frankly, it's exhausting, right? Because then you have to go to where they are. And I realize that's a great mode of communication. I loved hearing Nora Newcomb speak, that she has tools that might be useful to converse. And so to me, with all the work that you've done, and I've been reading a lot of stuff, even that Catherine Hayhoe has done, and I think one of our biggest difficulties is the strength of confirmation bias. Mm. And so confirmation bias is that even if you present someone with the facts, the more educated the person is, the better they are at defending what is their view, whether it's founded by scientific evidence or not. And so I'm definitely gonna look up Nora Newcomb's books now. But I'm interested in finding tools that we can give to scientists to help us. You know, people that do public outreach, we're always reinventing the flat tire. That's what our joke is. But if we can really get some tools that you can help us to communicate effectively, It's a really hard problem, and I would like to hear what you have to say on that.
Yeah, well, thank you for that. And if I didn't come speak at APS, I apologize.
you were going to Israel to give a talk that week.
There we go. Okay, I had a good excuse. Okay. Well, that's a great idea. Maybe, David, maybe the Academy, maybe we can set up a Dropbox or some kind of Google Hangouts where we can post papers on this issue, because I think that would be helpful. I think you're right. I think the scientific community does a huge amount of, I'm going to use that expression, flat tire reinventing that. But as we know, I mean, motivated reasoning, various cognitive biases, these are not brand new ideas. This has been around for a while. So I do think that, and I do obviously read some of that literature, and so that is important. And I think we can obviously learn from the research that has been done in this area. In terms of going where they are, I love that expression. I think that's absolutely right. And I think that, you know, in a way, sometimes scientists say to me, well, this is too difficult. I don't know how to do that. I don't know how to talk to these people. And I feel like that's kind of a cop-out, because you do know how to talk to these people, whoever these people are. I remember I did a workshop once at NCAR, the National Center for Atmospheric Research, and one of the scientists got up and he said, I don't know how to talk to people about my work. And I said, well, let me just ask a question here. There was about 70 people in the room. I said, how many of you have children? Most of them raised their hand. And I said, how many of you, I think the guy might have said, I don't know how to explain my work without differential equations. It was something like that. And I said, how many of you have children? Raise your hands. I said, how many of you sometimes talk to your children about your work? You know, they all raise their hands. And then I say, how many of you talk to your children about your work in exactly the same way that you talk to your scientific colleagues about your work? Right. Okay. So people got it. We do actually know how to talk in different registers, but we're not practiced at it. And we often don't have the help and support that we might need to do it well. And then also it takes time. And as you said, it can be exhausting. So we have to support each other to do this. We have to support our scientific colleagues. And so, of course, this gets into the whole, you know, academic reward structure. And so I'm a strong advocate that we should consider outreach to be part of our teaching mission, not our service mission, because most universities don't really count that, even though they say they do. And to think about this as, I mean, this is how I think about it myself. It's part of my teaching mission, that my teaching mission doesn't just take place in the classroom, or even now on Zoom, right? And it's not just at Harvard, that there's a much bigger audience out there. And I loved your phrase about going where they are, because it reminded me of, that's how I have always thought about teaching, even whether I'm in the classroom or wherever I am. And it reminds me of a metaphor that I, or an analogy I keep in mind. When I first started teaching, this was 30 years ago, and I lived in a place where there weren't too many animals that needed rescuing. So I had a cat that had kittens, and we found good homes for all the kittens. And I remember watching my cat with her kittens, because sometimes my cat would decide that she didn't like where the kittens were, that for whatever reason, it wasn't safe, it wasn't good. And she would pick them up and she would drag them along the ground to where she wanted them to be. And in the first few weeks, she did this several times, moving the kittens, dragging them. And I thought, well, that's kind of a metaphor for teaching. You know, my cat didn't just stand there and meow at the kittens and yell at them and tell them to get over where she wanted them to be. She didn't bang on the table and say they should understand differential equations or they should have already had chemical thermodynamics. No, she went to where they were and she brought them along to where she needed them to be. And that's kind of always been my philosophy of teaching. So, you know, day one in any class, I spend a little time asking the students, what do they already know? What do they think? You know, what does a certain word make, you know, what does a certain word conjure up in their heads in order to figure out where are they? Because that's where I've got to start. And that's the same whether it's freshmen at Harvard or first year graduate students at Harvard or folks at a church in North Dakota.
Let me just jump in at this point and say that right now the Academy is actually exploring a possible project in the area of climate change. So just to let all of you know that we are exploring the possibility of a commission in that area, since it's been obviously a topic frequently coming up right now. Let me ask W.E. Mourner to ask his question.
Yes, thank you very much. Hi, Naomi. It was good to see you again. Love your stuff. And in particular, I really loved what you said about uncertainty earlier. But I want to mention that once more as one of two small remarks. I believe that there is also a, a misunderstanding about the probability attached to a statement that scientists use all the time. There's sort of a general misunderstanding. And we actually need to take it on to educate people better about this issue, that they every day make choices with certain probabilities. Every day people choose, you know, on 10% probability of something going wrong, they'll get their, an operation on their arm or something like that. And so that I think that's basically a challenge for us. It doesn't really help with dealing with a skeptic directly. And then the other comment is with your original thesis that implications are driving responses by deniers. I wanted to ask, how do you get a denier to recognize or admit the implications that may be driving their response? How do you actually do that? That might be somehow too personal in some way or another. Thanks a lot.
Yeah, I'll take the second one first. It's always easier to do that. You know, I guess there are things that I could say about that, but I also think that at some point we're actually spending too much time and energy worrying about persuading deniers. I mean, the public opinion polls show that about 25% of the American people still don't think climate change is either happening or caused by people. Well, that's about the same percentage that don't think that smoking causes cancer. So that tells us something about the role of evidence in most people's lives. In other words, very small. But to have social change, to have political change, you don't need 100%. I mean, I think one reason scientists get very stressed about this issue is that in science, we don't say that something is known. We don't move on until we have pretty much, maybe not 100% agreement, but it's got to be really close, right? I mean, plate tectonics, which I wrote my first book about, was accepted in 1968 to 70, when basically something like 99% of all Earth scientists accepted it. And there were a few famous exceptions, and I could tell you who those were if you were interested, but it was overwhelming, right? So that's what we expect in science, but in politics and in life, we don't need that. We never have 99% agreement about anything in politics, or even 95. I mean, if we get 60-40 in an election, we consider that a landslide. So I think it's much more important for us to focus on not the deniers, not the hardcore, the people I call the refractories, you know, the ones you can't melt no matter what, but to focus on mobilizing the people who are committed, arming them with good information about what the solutions could look like, giving them good examples of places where solutions are being implemented, for example, in California today, and then work on bringing along the kind of the people in the middle who kind of know it's happening, but they're not really sure why it matters, or maybe they know it's happening, but it's not a high priority. Getting those people engaged, I think, is a far more important problem for us than sort of worrying about the refractory 25%. You know, some of you know Max Planck famously said, science advances one funeral at a time. You know, there are some issues that you just can't resolve, and you have to say, you know, it's just too bad about old Joe, and, you know, we move on, right? Okay, in terms of the probability issue, yeah, you know, there's so much to say about this issue, and there's no question that probability is a difficult area. People often don't understand it. There are good data on this. I was reading a paper just the other day. I can't remember the authors, but I could find it if people are interested, where they looked at, you know, the IPCC has gone to enormous pains to figure out what language to use to describe likelihoods about certain events. And then they've gone to equally enormous pains to try to put numerical boundaries on this language. I think a lot of what they've done is very problematic, but even if we just accept it as it is what it is. So this one study looked at the IPCC language and they asked people, when you hear the word likely, what do you think that means in terms of probabilities? And invariably, the numbers that people give are much lower than what the IPCC thinks those words mean. So that's telling us that there's a systematic misunderstanding on the part of scientists about what people hear when they hear a word like likely, very likely, extremely likely, words like that. But it gets even worse. So then these same scholars did repeat the study, and they actually give the people the numbers that the IPCC has put on these words. And then they ask the people, so what do you think the probability of this is? And they still give lower values, right? So this gets back to the cognitive issues that we were just discussing. There are things about the way people process information that non-cognitive scientists are misinterpreting and misunderstanding. And so clearly scientists who are trying to natural scientists who are trying to communicate issues to larger publics have got to do a better job understanding the cognitive frameworks in which people hear these claims.
Thanks. Bob Sokolow, you have a question?
Hello, Naomi.
Hey, Bob, good to see you.
I wonder how you think about another aspect of the climate communication, which is about solutions. Mm-hmm. Which solutions will be welcomed, which ones should be challenged. Nuclear power is certainly on that list, probably geoengineering, maybe some of the ways in which the biosphere would be used to deal with climate change. I think dealing with them requires placing climate change in a set of global threats rather than privileging it above all others. And that in turn may be a mechanism for building conversations that would not otherwise happen. Something similar to that will presumably emerge quite soon under the question of how we exit from the current coronavirus lockdowns and so on.
Yeah, that's a great point. And I think this fits with one of the things I said in the New Yorker interview. One of the things we know, both from personal experience and from studies, is that people don't like bad news. So if you tell people how terrible climate change is, but you don't offer a solution, for a lot of people, that's just not, you know, they want to walk away and not hear that. So I think you're absolutely right. It's terrifically important for us to be prepared to talk about the solution space. But that also requires us to do work. Because the fact is, the solution space, as you know, is really complicated. Geoengineering is a super complicated question. It involves a lot of different things. So some people, I mean, that term is used to refer to, sometimes reforestation, but also solar radiation management and also carbon capture and storage. So, you know, there's a lot of different things that get lumped under the term geoengineering. Nuclear power, obviously complicated, long, complicated history there. But also even something as simple as carbon tax versus emissions trading, right? Most people don't understand how emissions trading work. I've been in a room where I've heard vicious and violent arguments among economists about emissions trading versus carbon pricing. I've heard natural scientists say things about the history of taxation that are patently false. I've heard natural scientists say things about the history of nuclear power that are patently false. So if we're going to go into that space, it means we have work to do. And maybe this is something that the Academy could think about. Could we write a primer on, you know, what are some of the key issues about these technologies? What are some of the facts that, you know, we might want to know if we would like to be able to speak intelligently about these? Because I think you're absolutely right. If you can get people talking about the solution, it can be a way to break through the resistance to the bad news aspect of it.
That was my main point.
Yeah, and I also think you're right that it can be a way to kind of overcome some of the political and ideological barriers as well. Although that said, you know, for years, when I would speak to mixed audiences, one of the points I would try to make was that we do have market-based mechanisms to address climate change. And in fact, my own work on the implicatory denial led me to the position that, and it's the view I still hold, my feeling about climate change is we should try to fix it with the smallest government solution that will work. Right? Because I respect some of the reasons why people are worried about big government. And I don't consider those reasons to be all ridiculous or illegitimate. I think some of them are illegitimate, but I don't think they're all illegitimate. So the emissions trading for acid rain is a really important story. And for years, I used to talk about that. And I used to remind people that it was a Republican president, George H.W. Bush, who signed the Clean Air Act amendments, and that it worked, that we had a model. And to me, one of the tragedies of the last 20 years is the way the conservatives have abandoned emissions trading, because it was their idea. It was their solution, and it was a good one, actually. And exactly why that happened, again, is a really complicated question that would be worth people looking at in more detail, because if we could figure out a way to bring back the conservative support for emissions trading, that could potentially be a big breakthrough.
No one is rolling back the sulfur market in the coal.
No, exactly. Once you do it, and there's lots of good science. I was just rereading, you know, the Daedalus volume on the alternative energy futures. If you guys haven't read it or haven't read it recently, it's really worth rereading it, because there's a wonderful piece in it about exactly that. That once you can get the institutional structures in place to implement these policies, then often everybody gets used to it and everybody's fine, and you can even create constituencies that support it and want it to continue. And we saw that in Southern California with the emissions trading for air pollution as well. So we do have some good models out there. But you know, I talk a lot about emissions trading in California because I lived for many years in Southern California. Reclaim was the emissions trading program that cleaned up the air in Southern California. And almost no one knows about it. I mean, it is shocking to me how little even highly educated people in this space don't know about Reclaim. And that's a tragedy, and maybe we could fix that.
So we're coming toward the end, but three more people have raised their hands. So I want to try to get the last three questions in. So first, Joe Felsenstein.
Hi, I find your point very depressing, because I work in evolutionary biology and I do a certain amount of trying to analyze creationist arguments and refute them. And you're arguing that the people will change their mind when you point out that the consequences of their denial have negative consequences for them. In the case of evolutionary biology and acceptance of evolution, we don't really have that. We have to rely on persuading people based on the consistency with other sciences and the value of the science. So it's a kind of depressing situation that you leave us in. Maybe it's not a great tragedy for the nation, but
I think maybe it's not that depressing. I'd say for two reasons. I mean, we do have evidence that engaging with people on the implications can work. So there's a group at the Arizona State University who have worked on this. And again, if people are interested, we can dig up their papers and maybe get them in a Dropbox. But they did an experiment with students at Arizona State in biology classes, and forgive me if you know this already, but where they actually addressed this issue and they said, well, let's see how some scientists who are themselves biologists, but also people of faith, how they cope with that. And they had the students read writings by Sir John Houghton and Ken Miller and people like that. And they found that it did shift the conversation. It made the students much more willing to at least consider evolutionary theory. It made them more open-minded to it. We don't know, I guess you'd have to do a longitudinal study, and I don't know if they've done this, whether or not in the long run it totally shifts their views, but it definitely, they were able to show that the students became more receptive. So we do know that certain strategies based on acknowledging the problem of the implications can be effective. The other thing I would say, and this is important because sometimes I get misinterpreted as saying that facts don't matter, and I am definitely not saying that. Facts matter hugely to most of us, and they particularly matter to school teachers. So one of the things I've found in the last 10 years, especially I've done work with the California Science Teachers Association and also with NCSC, the National Center for Science Education. And shameless plug, if you're home earning a good living and want to give money to a charity, NCSC is like so great and has done such important good work across this country. One of the things we've found is that school teachers are incredibly hungry for good information and incredibly appreciative if you as a scientist can explain in plain language, you know, something that a school teacher can use, you know, what are the refutations to the creationist claims? That's really, really useful for school teachers. So if that's what you're doing, you should absolutely keep doing it. If you're already connected with school teachers, then just keep doing it. If you're not already connected, then join NCSC and we can get you connected with school teachers.
I agree. I'll just say that also I've discovered that, yes, you cannot really convert a hardcore denier, but what you can do is push people who are on the fence. And you can also help arm people who are already on your side with better arguments.
Oh, absolutely. Okay. So that's hugely important because I've been in places where people who were, quote, on my side said things that I was cringing over, right? And you don't want that to happen. So, you know, people often talk about the problem of preaching to the choir, but you know what? The choir needs support too.
Thank you. Jed Furman, you have a question?
Hi. I'm curious, when it comes to people denying the COVID science, what are their concerns that can't be addressed by better science and better data? Is it they don't think that lives are worth the money? Is it a tribalism? Is it some kind of political issues? What do you think?
Well, it's a little hard to say because, you know, I haven't been privy to what took place in Washington in the last few months, and I haven't too soon to get into the archives. I mean, so much of what I know about the Reagan and Bush administration is based on going to the Presidential Library. But I do address this a little bit in the LA Times piece. I think we saw the way our current president was reluctant to accept the reality of this because he's basically hostile to science. He's basically hostile to expertise. And I think that hostility has been nurtured and cultivated in the Republican Party. And I apologize if this sounds partisan, but I'm saying this as a historian, that hostility to science has been cultivated for 40 years in the Republican Party because of the perceived implications of environmental and public health science for free market ideology. I also think that there's a tendency for many politicians, not just Republican, but Democrats, to privilege the economy and to reify the economy into something that is almost sacred, a kind of deification of the marketplace. Michael Sandel has written about this, also Harvey Cox. And so when you have a challenge where you're going to do something that could hurt the economy, the reflux of many politicians is to say, I'm not going to do anything that's going to hurt the economy. And we saw that during the administration of George W. Bush. I don't know how many of you remember this, but when the issue of the Kyoto Protocol came up and George W. Bush said he would not sign the Kyoto Protocol because he would not agree to any treaty that would hurt the American economy or cost jobs. So that tells us also that we have to reframe that narrative, right? The mythology that environmental protection and public health cost jobs is wrong. And actually it's the opposite. It's not fixing the problem. I mean, this is going to be a big opportunity for us to make that case, right? Failing to stop this virus is now caused a huge, huge economic crisis. If we had actually addressed it sooner, we could have been in the place that South Korea is now. And that's going to be the really important empirical argument I think that we as scholars can make. I mean, this is a controlled experiment in a way, not quite, but almost, because we have these different countries that have responded differently, and we will be able to compare the death rates per million. I mean, we can already, but we'll have better data in a few more months. And South Korea is very different than what we're seeing here in the United States. And that's not about being communist or capitalist, that's about having an organized, centralized government response and listening to the scientific evidence, the advice.
Okay, our last question, Richard Garwin.
Thank you. It's more a point than a question. So I've been working full-time on COVID-19 for the last 6 weeks, and I have two papers, one distributed first a month ago and updated recently, Protecting Yourself and Family. And if you would like them, I'd be glad to let you have it. And also this morning, I had a 90-minute seminar with sort of 40 people in Paris and all over the world about, you know, the views about COVID-19, the epidemic, and the future. You might want that too. But we are in the United States where we are, in part because of positions taken by the people who in power. For instance, Robert Redfield, the head of the CDC, on March 11th testified to a House Oversight Committee that we will never have drive-through testing the way South Korea has in response to questions, because we didn't want to interfere with the relationship between the individual and his or her physician. And so you still hear from this administration that you can get tested, but you have to get your physician to order it. Who can talk to one's physician? And only 40% of the Americans have physicians. Yes. Anyhow, so we are in a very serious situation. We don't have to be China in order to learn from China. Epidemiology is the same there as it is here.
Dick, thank you so much for that. I always learn so much talking to you. So yes, please do send me and anyone else who's interested those papers. And I think you've hit on another really crucial thing that I haven't mentioned, which is American individualism. And again, this is a theme that runs through so many of the responses to so many of these crises that we've faced or have failed to face in recent years. And again, it's not that individualism is a bad thing per se, but it's a kind of excessive glorification of individualism that then hamstrings our capacity to have a collective response when we need it. And when you were speaking just now about the relationship between the individual and the physician, some of you may know Evelyn Hammonds, our good friend, has written about exactly this during the diphtheria crisis, which is now, 100 years ago, that many people were, doctors were, and some politicians were opposed to a massive public health campaign to vaccinate people against diphtheria for exactly that reason, because physicians said, no, this is interfering in the relationship between the patient and the physician. So this is obviously a complicated thing. If you have a physician you trust, then absolutely the relationship with your physician is an important thing. And we don't want the federal government telling doctors how to practice medicine. But of course, medicine and public health are not exactly the same thing. And when it comes to public health, we need something more than just the individual relationship between the patient and the physician.
Good. Thank you, Naomi. There's some questions about distributing results to everyone, and such as the paper that Richard just mentioned, and we'll certainly want to see what we can do to distribute that to all of you. So let me thank all of you for participating, and especially thank you, Naomi, for being willing to talk with us today. It's been a really wonderful discussion. Let me just mention to all of you that our next virtual event will take place on April 21. And it will involve Marcelo Suarez Orozco speaking about the biased treatment of immigrants during pandemics. So I hope you'll consider joining us for that. And so we'll have more discussions like this until we're able to meet in person again. So until next time, take care and thank you for joining us today.
Thank you all. Elbow bumps to everyone.